Good evening, all of you. Welcome for another session on webinar. So today we have a very unique topic on the island of macaques. I mean, we have a very, very interesting and very unique species of macaques found in Nicobar region. It's called long-tailed macaque. And not many people don't know there is a macaque exists like that in that place. Is it a long-tailed macaque only, no, Partha?
Yes.
Yeah. So yeah, not many people don't know the name itself. So I mean, their behavior, their family, their lifestyle, nothing much know, but Partha's done a lot of studies there. And I remember my friend actually helped him for a few months, and she came back and said, I want to adopt a monkey there. She was talking only about that monkey for a few months. So anyway, it was, I mean, I'm sure it will be a great talk. I mean, over to you, Partha. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, David, for inviting. Sorry, can you hear me?
Yeah, also suggest all of you can switch off your video except Partha, so you will get a better bandwidth. You can keep your video. Thank you. Over to you, Partha.
Okay. Thank you, Raju. And it's great to be here actually after hearing so many good talks over the period of time which has been organized by KNS, ANHS, and Red Earth. So I would like to thank them to invite me for this very distinguished talk, which I want to give. And I'm very happy to share actually my experience in Nicobar. And I have not been there for 3 years now. And any moment, any opportunity to talk about it, and I will just go over. I mean, people get bored at times with me. How many times you're going to talk about the islands? I said, I cannot stop it. So I hope after today, if I can have some glimpses of the island and the macaques which live there. So without further ado, I would like to jump in. So today my talk is on the island of macaques. So what island are we talking about and what macaque are we talking about? We'll come to that in a short while. So I would like to thank Dr. Kumara, who was my guide, who is still my guide. I have not gotten my degree yet. And I would like to introduce Arijit and Avadhoot, who will feature during this whole talk. So before I go any further, I would like to warm the people, the audience, by asking a simple question for themselves. You don't need to answer, just ask it to yourself. What do you really feel when you see a monkey? So this is what Arijit here in the picture, he's thinking, what do you really feel when you see a monkey? I'm sure most of us will have different answers for this. We will feel a lot of different emotions with these monkeys when we see them, when we approach them, when they approach us. So what are these emotions maybe? So it's a plethora of emotions. I cannot possibly put all of them together, but I have tried to encapsulate it in a few terms. Is it divination? And it's not an alien thing for us to think that monkeys or macaques or primates as such are mythological beings. In Hindu mythology, they have been accorded so much respect, and people worship them. It has been a reason for good, both good and bad, towards these primates. It's not only in India, it's also in Indonesia. If you go to Bali, there is a whole temple just for Rama and everyone and all the monkeys and these people, and everywhere in India, it has what they have done is they worship the monkeys. It has its own positive for the conservation and all, but it has also quite a few negative points of it, like feeding the monkeys, which actually creates a lot of problem, because when you get free food and no predators, you proliferate, and then the numbers get so high that you don't know what to do about them, and the governments and the local people, everyone is just you don't know what to do. For example, in Himachal Pradesh, the problem of rhesus macaque went so far that the government said, okay, we are allowing you to kill a monkey, just shoot a monkey, bring the body, we'll give you 150 rupees per macaque. Did it work? No, it did not, because again, we find this monkey divine, and I don't think we can actually ever do anything when it comes to the worshipping of people. but we can actually control some of it, that how do we really need to feed these macaques, or really, so there can be some. So we'll not go very deep into that. The second thing which we really see is maybe connection. When we see a monkey with a mother, adult with a infant, you can sometimes very, you know, you can feel the connection between them, and you can feel the connection we feel with our siblings, with our children, with our parents and whatnot, like a family, right? I mean, they stay like a family. Many of the species, most of the species except prosimians, they all stay together, they stay like a family. So we have some connection with us and them, which we again feel. And is it affection? So this episode happened while I was taking data, and this guy just comes over to me and just starts pulling my pants. It looks like he wants ice cream from me or something, because I don't have it. Like, just another kid would ask me, please get me some ice cream. So it looked like that, but I cannot really know what is going on there. But definitely you feel kind of affection at times, because of which we also feed these macaques at times, which again becomes a problem. So we have to balance our emotions at times, and to treat this monkey in a way that we respect the way they are, so that they are natural and they are kept natural, as well as we can enjoy them being in the wild. And this is a non-scientific term I'm using, which is cuteness. But of course, when you see a monkey baby or a monkey which was really good to watch, you say, oh, that this guy is so cute. So as you can see, the baby which I was studying in one of the groups, I'm sure almost all of you might think this is a cute baby. So that's another emotions, or I would say positive emotion, that is there. Or it can be a negative emotion, like a nuisance. So what's happening in this photograph is that some of us were looking at few individuals towards this side, and we were completely focused on them. So what happened, we just let our guard down, and we put our bags there. And in 1 minute, this guy, so he came and started pulling our bag. And we said, okay, we can't give you our bag, because it, of course we cannot. So he did not like it, obviously. And he started because for him, he found it first. And if I don't give him, then I'm trying to take what is his. So again, before we turn these things, these animals into certain terms, we have to understand where they are coming from, or what is the context of certain behavior which they are so showing to us. So nuisance, maybe you can say there's a nuisance in that, they are naughty about it. So this bag came in one piece, but there was some, no, not in one piece, there were some pieces missing in that. Or sometimes aggression can be really bad from the monkeys towards the humans, and also from humans to the monkeys as well. So when I'm talking, I'm not talking about all the primates today. So monkeys is a very general term which usually people do not use. Either we use like langurs or macaques, but I'll keep it more common. But if I have to go specific, then I'll talk about macaques. So here in these two pictures are also from Nicobar. So the farmers keep complaining about how the monkeys are, or the macaques are so intelligent that they'll eat the coconut right from the tree. They don't even have to break it. They don't have to get it to the ground. They are expert, they maneuver it so well that they actually eat it from the top, and you cannot do anything about it. Sometimes, like on the right side of the screen, there's this dog who is a guard dog for farmers. He was guarding, and because he was the only one, he cannot fight off all the macaques that are coming to raid or to access the farm there. So he got badly bitten and got really injured. So it's kind of an interface where humans, dogs, and I would say macaques, they are all living together, in a way finding a way to, you know, just coexist. Or the macaques can just mean data. These are the three Nicobar trimates we call each other, after Jane Goodall and all, because we are take the rip to take us to that podium. So we three just looked at the monkeys and the macaques and looked at their behavior. We recorded everything. And so for us and many other scientists, it's data to understand what the behavior really means, to get a real good look at their lives, to understand what they really do. Or again, coming back, it's like it could be all the emotions together. I can feel cuteness towards them. I can feel them that they are holy. I can feel that they are cute. But also I can mean that they are data for me, and I will have to have an objective outlook for them. And there are many more emotions which I may not be able to fathom. So that's what we feel about the monkeys in general. So it comes from the values and ethos and experience which we are born with, and over time how we gather those experiences. And usually we all love to coexist with each other, but sometimes when the livelihood or your very survival is at stake, things get really bad out there, but we can mitigate. But we'll not go there. I'm going to keep it as a very simple talk, as much as I want to keep it as much as possible to be focused on macaques as well as all on the islands. So when I'm talking about macaques, how many do we have? We have actually 10 macaque species in India, believe it or not. And so that makes sense to say that India is actually a land of macaques. Very few countries have that many macaques. I don't know if any other does, and a country has that many macaque species in them. And I have divided them into three groups based on their distribution. Rhesus macaque, of course, it's not a priority list or anything, but just it was just written like that. So rhesus macaque, most of us will be familiar with this macaque because this has been captured imagination for years by people all over the world, maybe. And this has been covered the most by even, I would say, documentary series like Monkey Thieves, and how the society works. And they are one of the most notorious and infamous macaques. But again, whether it is their fault or our fault, it's a slippery slope to go that way. And it can sometimes, the next one is Assamese macaque, which is found in Northeast India. And sometimes why I'm writing this tripartite coloration in rhesus and Assamese are that some of the areas where Assamese and rhesus are found together, it might be a little confusing to identify Assamese macaques and rhesus macaques apart. So the best thing is that if you can see the other picture on the top, there are two or three different types of coloration on the fur for rhesus macaques. However, Assamese macaque has a brilliant golden fur on them. The next one is a very recently found macaque, and which is the Arunachal macaque. It was found by a group of scientists from NCF, and this picture is also from this. So they are really deep in the forest in Arunachal Pradesh. And then this is the latest macaque in the whole list of it, which is white-cheeked macaque, Macaca leucogenes, which is also found in Arunachal. And then we have northern pigtail macaque. So pigtail macaque again has two species, Macaca leonina and Macaca nemestrina. So nemestrina is down from the south, and which starts from Thailand and below. And from some part of Thailand and above to India, we have northern pigtail macaque, and which is found in Northeast India. And the best place to see them, I think, is Gibbon Wildlife Sanctuary. And we again have stump-tailed macaque in India, which is again found in Northeast India. And again, Assam is a really great place to watch this. And then we have a record of Tibetan macaque skin, which was found in 2005 by a group of scientists from NCF again. So this has verified that, okay, these macaques are there in India, but they haven't been seen much. Okay, then I come to our South India, where I have been working for quite some time now. We have bonnet macaques, which is the most common macaques in South India. And they are endemic again to Southern India. They are not found anywhere else in the world. Although they are least concerned, I would say there are some matters of concern even for them, because there are people who are living again in the close interface with bonnets. If you go to any travel place now for Bangalore, if you go to Nandi Hills, in Kerala, if I am right now in Tenmala, if you go there, you just see so many macaques out there. This picture is from one of the biggest. If you go to any temple areas, you will find a lot of bonnet macaques there. So this picture is from Chamundi Hills in Mysore, where you can find monkeys all over the place. And few of my lab mates and friends have been working on them for many, many years right now. My pardon. So, and the next is perhaps the most charismatic macaque or primate, which arguably is the most charismatic species of primates. And very recently, it captured imagination of the Western people as well, because of the very famous video which captured these macaques slapping a giant squirrel for a jackfruit. So although being a very important and very charismatic species, they are actually very threatened. Why? Because they are very specialist. So macaques are known to be very generalist about their behavior, their habitat, because they have so much, I would say, behaviors which would actually allow them to adapt to every situation they are in. But lion-tailed macaque is a special macaque in this case, because it lives on a canopy. It's a canopy-dwelling macaque species, and it requires continuous stretch of forest, which we are lacking right now. And more forests are getting cleared up, and the numbers are dwindling. I mean, the numbers used to be worse. It's slightly better, but they are not out of danger yet. So now it brings me to the species which I worked on, and it's the southernmost part of India where we find it, and that is Great Nicobar Island. Yes, that is the southernmost part of India. I mean, and it is actually so far from India that the nearest place from that island is Indonesia, which is like 125 kilometers. So sometimes people actually sleep on the boat and they reach in Indonesian jail next day. So that has happened. So the long-tailed macaques which are found there is Macaca fascicularis umbrosus. So I will come back to that in a short while. Before that, I want to talk about Macaca fascicularis. So they are actually very widely distributed if you see the distribution scale. As you can see in the map here, right away from very close to Myanmar till Papua New Guinea, it has been recorded, and it has been introduced even in Mauritius. So you can see it's a very widely distributed primate, and the interesting thing is it is actually the third most distributed primate in the whole world. Number one being us. Yes, we are primates. I'm sure it doesn't come as a shock to everyone. So we sometimes, because a great scientist called Franz De Waal, he sometimes say that we are glorified apes. And then there are the second most widely distributed macaque is rhesus macaque, which we have already talked about. And the third is fascicularis, and it is found on three small islands of Southern Nicobar group. As you can see, when I am looking at this map, I can hardly see India even there, and I'm seeing most of Indonesia and Southeast Asia. So you can imagine how distinct they are from their population is from the rest of the monkeys, and there is absolutely no connectivity even for this subspecies, which is found only in these islands, and there are other subspecies which are color coded in different islands. So there are 11 subspecies, and sorry, this name has been changed now. It is no more Umbrosa, it is Umbrosus now. My apologies for that. So now coming to the species. So Macaca fascicularis umbrosus. So umbrosus, what does it mean? I mean, umbrosus comes from the word umbra. Umbra is the dark side of the moon. So I call these macaques the monkeys from the dark side of the moon. Just sounds cool that way. So these are one of the subspecies of Nuzcracker fascicularis, and these are again restricted to three islands. I repeat that so that it registers. So because how dangerous they are, how close they are living to danger, because their restriction, their distribution is so restricted. And again, there has been a big population decline after 2004 tsunami, which most of us you might remember for that. We'll come back to that again. And IUCN Red List has given them a vulnerable status. There has been some discussions about them accorded to endangered as well. But right now they are vulnerable, and it's truly so because it's actually threatened. We'll see why. And for Indian Wildlife Protection Act, they are Schedule 1, which means the highest protection. So where did I conduct my study? Was it a paradise? I would say yes, it was. But I was still alive when I was there. And this is a pandanus fruit, and this is the favorite fruit of Macaca ambrosus. So so this was a place which was ravaged by tsunami of 2004. It was the most groundbreaking event in the history of the islands. And if you go to the island, if you talk to a person, the whole timeline has shifted from before and after tsunami. So if you talk to them, people will ask, oh, were you there before tsunami or after tsunami? So that, I mean, it was so devastating. I mean, not only devastated the whole area, in big areas in Southeast Asia, like Thailand, Indonesia, it had a big impact even in mainland India. And being so close to the epicenter, Andaman and Nicobar had a big, big impact, had a big loss of things from this tsunami. So it was actually a map-changing event. So we have a lot of catastrophes around. I mean, we had Amphan, which was actually very close to my place. But this was something which absolutely changed the map of this area. So you see the photograph on your right, that this boat is there and there is water inside and there are trees like that. So this used to be the rainforest, and the water used to be some, at this place, the water used to be some 1.5 kilometers away from here. But now the water has receded so far that I went towards this side and it was around 1 kilometer even inside. So you can imagine the level of water inundating the area. And so it was, so again, it's like 2 kilometers, up to 2 kilometers on an average, the water traveled inland. And Nicobar again was severely affected. As you can imagine, like 1/5 of the population, I mean, it's a huge loss. Like 1/5 is not a small number. And it was a big loss. And secondarily, the economic loss was just too much for people. And although many programs were announced, still people, some of them are living in really, really bad shape. Okay, that was for humans. What about macaques? Again, this place is called Magar. No, this was not Magar. This was somewhere a little far off. And this place is completely submerged now. As you can see, the big tall trees now. These are really, really tall trees. These are rainforest trees. So the water, it should not be even here. But now the water is they are here for a long, long time now, and it's not going to go down anytime soon. So you can see, and throughout the island, so I have been one of the luckiest ones who could actually circumnavigate the whole island for a crocodile survey. And whenever you go into creeks and every place, you would see these graveyard, I would say. I would say this graveyard of trees everywhere. And it's a haunting sight, I would say. And so, just a second. I am having some issues with my computer. Okay. So, but before that, we'll come to that again. Okay. So, did we know about these macaques to begin with? So, the first idea of these macaques was long back in 1863 when one merchant ship or some missionary ship, which I'm not very clear about the details, had procured a dead macaque from these islands, which was actually circumnavigating, because missionaries used to circumnavigate the whole island, and somehow they were near the Great Nicobar Islands, and they found a dead body. And Blyth was the one who actually collected it, and he recorded it, and however it again took so many years to describe it by Miller, which was done in 1902. After that, there was a big gap. No information about this macaques whatsoever. The first major study was done by Dr. Umapathy from CCMB, along with Dr. Mewar Singh and Dr. Mohammed. And Dr. Umapathy actually went to all these islands and published with the first paper, which gave an overview of how these macaques are and where these macaques are, what do they do. So they found that these macaques actually prefer coastal areas because they eat pandanus, the fruit which I was talking about a few minutes back in the photograph, and coconut. So they are more or less dependent on these trees. Again, that means they are preferring the coastal areas. After that, what happened? So as you can see, tsunami. I mean, if they are near the coastal habitat, you can always add 1+1 and see that, okay, these macaques would have been really, really hurt badly because of the tsunami. So Shivakumar from WII, he recorded that there was a massive loss of population for Nicobar long-tailed macaque when he compared his data with the pre-tsunami data, which was gathered by Dr. Umapathy. And as you can see, these blue areas in some of the islands, so these blue areas are now underwater. So these are by no means small areas. And even on the west coast of Great Nicobar, a lot of blues. And so these are the group locations where they were studied before and studied. And as you can see, many of them have now receded towards the inland areas. Okay. So now you can see that the most of the habitat was badly affected by the tsunami, and because of that there was a huge loss of food patches for them, and that's why the macaques faced a primary loss of life because of the incoming waves, but also they had faced a lot of secondary population decline because the habitat faced such a big loss. Now we'll come back to what we did. So this is the place where we worked. It's a place called Campbell Bay, which is the most inhabited place in Great Nicobar Island. I would say in any Nicobar Islands, this is the most, I would say, posh area. So I have a small story I would like to share, if you're okay with this. So all the three of us, we started absolutely having zero idea about this place. So Avdhoot, who actually landed first to this island, before that he thought, okay, we have to carry a tent, we had to have solar panels and everything, and he carried all those things from Chennai. So the only way to reach Campbell Bay is for you to take a ship or bus, or flight from Chennai or Kolkata, and now Vizag also. Chennai or Kolkata, you have to take ships, and you either go directly to Campbell Bay from Chennai, which is just a few ships, or you have to go to Port Blair, which is the northernmost part of Andaman and Nicobar, take another ship which takes around 1.5 days for you to reach Campbell Bay. So very first night I reached there, it was all dark, so I had no idea where I was. The very next morning, these people took me to the topmost area, and this is the place you can see. This is where we lived. So this is the bay area, and you can see that on the other side there is a road, and this place is just, it's called mini India, because just like this football ground, you can see a lot of colors of t-shirts. You can have actually a lot of people from different parts of India. They have in the island two native tribes. One is Champin and another is Nicobaris. Nicobaris are found throughout the Nicobar Islands and also Andaman Island, because they have somehow mixed with the incoming settlers from mainland. And however, Champin is still, I would say, very native, and they stick to their own, stick to themselves. They hardly interact with people from the settlers or the other people. So we did not know much about Champins until there was a small survey by Archaeological Survey of India, and they say that Champins, there are 9 bands as in groups, and they are spread throughout the island. they do not live near the coast except for one band, which is seafaring. So they are completely dependent on resources which they found in the jungle, in the whole Great Nicobar Island. And very recently they have come out and they are exchanging some things with local people, but then again it's a restricted population. And then you have Nicobarese people who are known for their seafaring prowess. They're excellent swimmers, excellent fishermen. So, and they have helped a lot in our work. And this is the coastal coconut plantations of people. So as you can see, after many, many years, some of these plantations were really hard to go to. So many of them are completely abandoned by the farmers, and it is obviously loss for them. But this is what has happened due to tsunami. And again, this is another scenic view. And if you're lucky, you will find the dolphins jumping around when you're at the beach. So this was Camp Bay where we started our work. As you can see, this is a small, small place in the Great Nicobar Island. This is just the bay area, and this is just one group which we studied. And this is the home range, that blue lines which it denotes, and the habitat condition where it was. And it was this, and it was surrounded all side by the sea. So why we went there? What was the reason for that? So the main idea behind this project was to understand that what this population and how this population is actually faring right now. So the last work was done by Dr. Shivakumar in 2010. And since we know that macaques are actually very adaptable, as I have told earlier, that they are very adaptable to whatever conditions you throw them into. So was it a case or not with this population? Was a decline in population there? There are, what are they eating there? I mean, what is the feeding behavior? We wanted to know that. Reproduction is, again, it's a very interesting thing to see that how the reproductive behavior will be shaped in these macaques, because the number of the population will depend on how the behavior is now. And also wanted to know how the social behavior and the relationships among the individuals were shaped there. So, we among ourselves, we distribute, okay, which we will take the topic which we love the most. So feeding behavior and population was done by Avdhoot. Reproductive behavior and sexual selection in the macaques, that was looked by Arijit. His thesis is there, you can always read it. And also, but I was more interested in understanding how the social behavior is in the groups, how the relationships are formed. I mean, we know that during the hard times, for example, in these corona times, we know how some of the relationships are, they are facing problems right now, right? I mean, when it comes to the resources and it is less in number, the competition increases, and then that's why your relationship quality will go down. Whether that is the case or not, I was interested to see that. So, and our investigation began after that. So these are the macaque individuals we used to follow. And we followed one group, which we named TR. So the interesting, you want to know what TR means? It is called Temple Run, because it used to run from temple to temple. Yeah, okay. Temple Run in Campbell Bay. So problem again, we did not realize that all three of us was absolute rookies. We had no experience in primatology before that. And we had read a lot of papers, but when it comes to groundwork, it's just a different ballgame altogether. Sorry. And we thought we will start out by studying more than two groups so that we have comparisons between them, so that we know things properly. It could not be done. In the end, we had to settle for one group. We thought, okay, fine. Rather than having, missing information, a little information from all of the groups, let's have proper information from one group. But it wasn't easy as well. I mean, these macaques, they were not habituated of humans being very close to them throughout the day. So we have been chased away. We have been growled upon. we used to get completely surrounded, and we cannot make eye contact to them, we cannot show our teeth to them. So we just used to freeze, and they used to scare but never harmed us. And after a point of time doing this, I mean, after going through so many traumatic events, we finally got their trust, and we were close to them and the group after 1 year. So just 1 year just gone to gain trust. I mean, the relationship was, that's why, stronger, I would say. So meanwhile, we surveyed all the islands. I mean, when I say me, it was mostly Avdhoot, because he was there. He is the only one among us who has been to all the three islands to check what this population is doing. And he surveyed all these places where Dr. Umapathy and Dr. Sivakumar's work was concentrated. And to make a comparison that, okay, these macaques might be doing better or not. So, and that's how it began. And on the islands, back on the islands where we are, on in Campbell Bay, when we are studying the group, we are following these macaques. So we, what we do is two or three different kind of samplings, which has been like a rule of thumb kind of a thing. So the first method is, you don't have to remember this, I want to share the technical details of studying behavior of any animal. The first one is a focal animal. As the name suggests, you know all the individuals of the group. You have named all the individuals for your identification. So you know A, B, C, D. So you want to know how each individual, what it does throughout the day, like its daily activity budget, or how it interacts with other individuals. So we followed individuals for 10 minutes and see whatever that individual does. And then we switched to the next individual. And we did that for, from 2013 to 2017. It seems like a lot of time, but the number of days were, it was curtailed down because of many issues which we had there. Because this group, again, I would focus on that it was not well habituated. It wasn't really happy about us being there all the time. So sometimes we, even after 1 year of habituation, and they are looking at us that we are there, they know who we are, we still got chased many of the days. And it was difficult for us to again gain their trust on that particular day. Other challenges? Okay, to find them. So what we did, we used to wake up really early in the morning. So the sun rises really early there. Around 5 o'clock, you will see the whole sunrise, sun up and above. So we have to reach where they have slept the day before, so that we know where they are sleeping, so that we reach before the sun actually rises. So we used to be there by 4:45 in the morning most of the days. And we wait for these monkeys to actually come down. And on the days where we fail to do that, it would have been a real, real problem for us, because it is so hot out there that it really drains you out. And again, this is the the vegetation. So the problem is they are not very arboreal. They would go underneath these plants which are growing, the undergrowth of the major trees, the big trees. And you know these macaques are there, but you cannot see them. I don't know which animal I have to follow. I know these guys are there, but I don't know which one is which. So I have to just wait for them to get out so that I can start recording them. And again, I have to wait for proper light, because these guys are the macaques from the dark side of the moon. So if the lighting is not proper, I have no way to know who the macaques are in the darker canopy or pardon. I'll just take a second break. I'll just have some water. All right. So, but again, no excuses, of course, when you're working. So then again, the problem was that there is no distinction of seasons on the island. They are tropical islands. There are just two distinct islands. One is dry season and there is just wet season. And the wet season is really wet. It rains for up to 14 days without any break, and you just cannot do anything about that because you just cannot step out of the home. So it was very difficult again to follow them, but we did what we had to. And sometimes the island also creates kind of a claustrophobia. I mean, you love the islands, you love the beaches, you can go to the forest, but at some point of time you feel like, oh, it's island. Am I like completely restricted to this? Do I ever get out? And these kind of thoughts, they do come. But overall, it was a lot of fun. Now, if I look at what we really did and what were the findings, and those are really actually very interesting. So good news was that the population has actually recovered from the tsunami. So Velankar et al., which is like our first paper which came out, which showed that the population has actually bounced back from tsunami. I mean, and they have recovered. So for more information, you can always read this paper. I would always suggest you to. And but the good news and the underline is that this population is has bounced back. But I will not say that we have to be complacent about this, because again, as I have said, these macaques are range restricted. Only three islands, and these three islands are again prone to storms, prone to earthquakes, tsunami. I mean, every month there are two times when they test the alarms for tsunami. So they keep it ready so that they are ready for another tsunami whenever it has to come. So you can imagine even the macaques are always living under some kind of stress from environment. So they have to maximize what they are doing and maximize the energy efficiency by doing the things how they do it. So they are still not out of danger, and we should make sure that we know more about them and also try to preserve them. Okay, so that was about the population. And this was another very exciting thing we found in the macaques. I don't know if I can play a YouTube thing here. Just give me a second.
Give it a try. It might work. Yeah.
Might work, right? Okay. Right. Let me just check this.
There might be a bit of issue with the audio.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Oh, I have to. But it's okay. You can just read. I think it's just music, background music with that video. Just bear with my internet for a while. All right, so that was it. So I'll go back to the presentation. Okay, hope you enjoyed that. So we were like astounded by thinking that, okay, we have read that. Okay, my bad, my YouTube is not closed. Sorry, my bad. So, we saw these macaques doing that, and we have read that if to do a particular kind of manipulation with something which is not a part of the substrate, you need to have a higher mental ability. And what you've seen there is that these macaques actually floss their teeth. So they have better dental hygiene than most of us, I would say. And they also use tools. So what they do is sometimes these coconuts will be falling out from the tree, and it will be on the grass, and it will be completely wet. So what they do is they cannot grip sometimes, and they will look for something like a leaf, and they will wrap it up around the coconut and they will try to just bite it and try to open it. So they are smart enough to know, okay, this is, and that's not it actually. So sometimes the leaf might not, may be attached to a plant. So sometimes it might not be coming out. So what it does is it actually breaks and makes a kind of a mechanism which actually helps them to, you know, hold the coconut and break it open to get the water. Besides that, they also rub, so they know which is sticky, and also they just gather all the leaves. Or sometimes what they do is some these coconuts might be hard to break, as you have seen in one of the YouTube one of the portion of that video, that one macaque was just, you know, very vigorously, you know, was pounding the coconut. So that was very, a lot of fun to see. He wasn't there at first, so the place where he found the coconut was a soft ground. Somehow he knew that he won't be able to break the coconut there and use whatever is there inside the substrate. So he came to that particular log, which is hard enough a place, and then and others followed him. The ones next to him, they followed him and they waited for the coconut to break. So, and the whole video, if you watch till the end, not this one, the one I have, is he actually succeeds. And they do that a lot. They have the sense of cognition, they have the cognition to know that, okay, if I do not, I cannot break the monkey, which I can, the coconut, which I am finding here, I can take it and to a harder place and break it there. So, which shows that they are actually, intelligent. And we used to have so lot of arguments between me, Avdhoot, and Arijit, and we sometimes come up with accidental terms, one of it which is human langur. So that came out because of how similar they were to humans and how smart they are. And now these macaques are intelligent, but we like to call them intellectual as well. Why this is different is also because this is not found in all the monkeys, because we have been talking, and my colleague Arijit, he is also trying to look at this in different species right now, but surprisingly it is not present in all the species apparently. And then this another event which I would like to focus on, which takes a cue from Game of Thrones, the book or series, you name it. So what happened is this old alpha Rusty on the left was, he got into a very aggressive fight with another male who was frequenting the area which was frequented by this TR group. And this other male, he kept coming every day. And so one day there was a huge fight, and the fight was so severe that the old alpha Rusty, he lost the left hand, and Fury was the one who completely, you know, overtook Rusty. And as you can see, but all in all, that what happens, we should not say that, oh, that is bad. Rusty was, I mean, we do have connection again to an old Rusty and a new Fury. We don't like him. He's being too oversmart. The problem is again that Rusty, after a few weeks, succumbed to his injuries and he died. So we were able to communicate as a paper as well, and we could see that this is not very common when it comes from a member, a new alpha which is coming from a group which is from another group. So usually when another individual comes from another group, a fight becomes more violent, because so I'll give you a small example. So A and B, or Rusty and X, suppose they are living in this group for maybe 10-15 years now, and they know each other, they know their strength, they know their weaknesses. So usually when there is a chance of X taking over Rusty, he would know when to attack. the fights are usually not that violent because they both know how much they are about to lose with that fight, because they both know their weaknesses as well as their strength. So, but here, Fury was unknown to Rusty. That's why the fight was really violent. And just like the way Cersei would say that when you play the Game of Thrones, you either win or die. Unfortunately, Rusty died after a few weeks. However, Fury was a good father, I would say. And they have a social network. So it's not just us wasting all of our time on Twitter. I'm talking about myself. So they have their own social network and they have their own relationships which they build on over time. And we found that they have hierarchy. So every social animal, they have kind of a hierarchy in them, and every individual is ranked and power is distributed according to the rank. And so what we found from our study is that males in the group, and again coming a little prior to that, like males are not expected to be very friendly with each other. They of course would try to overthrow the alpha always. So there is a strata of hierarchy among each of them, and each of them will have different power differentials among them. So and the main reason why they don't really, males do not really form great friendships, I'm using that word with a pinch of salt, as Dr. Johan Silk will also do, that the main reason macaques fight is for mate. If there is mating involved, there is no way one male can share the mate with another, which is not the case with females. Females can share food. Food can be shared. Mates cannot be shared. That's why males fight a lot among themselves, and they are not expected to be forming great relationships. But in, this has a gradient. Like many species where the monopolizability, like one individual cannot mate with many females. In those conditions, there is some chance for each individual in the group to gain some access to the females for mating. In that case, the fights are less, and that's where the bonding is a little stronger among the males. So in that regard, long-tailed macaques, as fasciculares, not, I'm calling about it as a species trait, they will be, they are in the middle somewhere, where they are not very anti each other or not very friendly with each other. And I wanted to see that whether that is the case here as well. And I found that it is the case, because, and it seems like it was a species characteristic that males actually form social relationships. Although those social relationships are social relationships, this is so tough to use so many sources for a Bengali. Social relationships for a macaque, to say that, okay, so the strong relationships are formed between the males, but they are not equal. So they are reciprocated. When can we say that the relationship is stronger? Only when it is two-way street. So I give something, I get back something. That's how strong relationships work. But this amount of giving and taking also has to be equal for that relationship to take one step further and to be called a bond or quote-unquote friendship, which again has, I would use with a pinch of salt. So here in this macaque, what I found was that relationships were not equally reciprocated. So the relationships are there, they are strong, but they are not strong enough to be called as bonds. And grooming. So I'm pretty sure that all the people, all of the people here, whoever have seen macaques and primates, as of now, any not solitary ones. So grooming is like the major thing that they do throughout the day. You will always see a monkey scratching the back. So why do they do that? I mean, if I scratch you, I'm losing my time to eat. What do I get out of that? So what we have found that it actually does a lot of things. It alleviates stress. So if I'm so many times, what happens after a fight? Between A and B, C will come to A and try to groom that individual so that the stress level of A comes down. Sometimes it might happen for C as well. If C is stressed, it will go to another individual and start grooming. And it has been seen that, again, because of that, the stress level again decreases. Again, not because of that. It is actually a trade relationships. When I was talking about males, or the relationships like give and take, this is one of the most important commodity or the currency, I would say, which is important to say that, okay, if this is done properly, if the currency exchange is proper, then the relationship is better. So here, as I would like to mention, that grooming is business or trading. And trading is done with whom? Who can provide us the most? So it is expected that high-ranking individuals, since they are most strongest one, will have the most resources with them. Is it the case though? So of course they were important and they were groomed more in case of high-ranking females. However, the males were not that groomed more. The high-ranked males were not groomed more by the low-ranking individuals. Why is that so? Again, the reason being simple. High-ranking females can usually groom another female. Are groomed because they will have food resources with them, to which a lower-ranking individual would want access to. So there is someone. If Arijit is, you know, higher ranked than me, and I would like to groom Arijit so that Arijit likes me and makes me eat his Cadbury. So let me eat it. So, in a way, that is to access to a food resource which is important to the lower ranking individual and also to the higher ranking individual as well. So grooming is important to me or Arijit to, you know, really get his stress lower. And so he's gaining grooming, and in exchange he can give me access to food or access to infant, or he can help me when I'm fighting with AP Avadhoot. So yeah. Why males won't do it? Again, it's simple. It's about mates. Mates cannot be shared. So no matter how much the lower ranking macaque will groom the higher ranking macaque, there he will not get access to mating. So now coming from all this behavioral thing to a very small thing which we did, which was not a part of the project, but we did because we wanted to. And I don't want to get into the details of it because I know many friends of mine who have worked on it for a longer period of time, like a group in Mysore University and Ishika from NCBS, and now CWS, who have been working on the coexistence of long-tailed macaques and the people there. So we did a very short survey. We just wanted to know that what is the condition, what is the perception of the people towards these macaques, because many of the settlers like are from mainland, from Tamil Nadu, maybe from Punjab, the ex servicemen, they have been settled there, so they have farms and they have been given areas where they can farm. But these macaques are really smart and they are more in numbers. Sometimes they can actually raid the areas and eat up all whatever is there. So as you can see in this picture, these two individuals are waiting for that guy to go. Once he is gone, these bananas will be gone in no time as well. So we did a small socioeconomic survey and very shortly we found that the perception of farmers is negative towards the macaques. Very specific though that is, because the poor farmers have more negativity towards the macaques, which is kind of intuitive because you're poor, you're losing it, so you will have less tolerance for the macaques. The second complaint was there from the farmers was that about market. So again, the population of the island is very small, I would say, and it's very distributed throughout the, so throughout Great Nicobar Island, if you see, it's a longitudinal, so it has two roads only. One goes to 35 kilometers north-south, and another one is just 13 kilometers north-south, east-west. So the people are living only on these two, around these two roads, and it's completely spread out. So the market is in Campbell Bay, which is like the main township, and the people actually come from all these places to sell their items. But again, the consumer base is not there, and whatever you grow does not really come out of the island. So that is a problem. And another problem was lack of logistics. So another thing which I missed with market was that there are two places which buys coconut. So coconut is like the major cash crop, I would say, for the farmers. And the problem is that these coconuts are not standardized. So there is no standard size to price chart where you can like give a big coconut, just one coconut will cost maybe the same like two coconuts and things like that. So there is no standardization. So those things are also a problem. And there's a lack of logistics. Like there are 8 villages total in Great Nicobar, and there is just one tractor. So you can imagine the lack of logistics, which is quite a problem there. And they do not get labor there. The laborers, again, the charge is very high. And to get a coconut, to get a coconut from the tree, to get it down, and to take it to a nearest copra center, it takes a lot of money. And some at one point of time, the price which they were getting were 2 rupees less than the whole paraphernalia around the harvest of coconuts. And there was a lack of logistics we have talked about. And there is another problem, which is like relocation. So what happened is this, I told you about that people are living around the roads on this angular road. The problem is they used to be more scattered before. And people used to stay very close to the farm before tsunami. And things used to be, they used to guard their farms very easily, and they can do things. But what happened was many of these areas are now hard to go to. So relocation was that in some point places, like there's this place called Shastri Nagar and this place called Lakshmi Nagar, people were actually staying near to the farms. But after tsunami, many of these houses were completely washed off. Some of the farms were really hard to go to. So what government did was took this people and they took them to a higher place and shifted to another place called Joginder Nagar. Problem is, Joginder Nagar is very far and you have to be dependent on bus timings. The first bus starts around 6 o'clock, and by the time you reach there, it's 7 o'clock. The sunrise again, as I told you, is at 5 o'clock. So by the time you reach your farm, your coconut plants are gone. Your vegetables are gone. So that is a problem, with one of the problems with which can be dealt with actually if there are more logistic and economic support to the islands. Another interesting thing which I learned was people told me that macaques actually know the tide timings. So what happens is some of these coconut plantations are sometimes cut off when the tide rises. So there is a high tide, no one can access that. Maybe people can when they are on the boat. So sometimes they take a small boat and they go to the coconut plantations. Macaques can't do that sometimes. But sometimes when you're located that far, they know when the tide timings are. So they wait, that's according to the farmers again, they wait for the tides to go down so that they can actually cross this and go to the coconut areas. So it also shows the desperation of these macaques. It's not that they're doing out of fun. It's like the food is really low for them as well. So that's how it goes there. And another problem was that they told us that none of the things which you can grow in mainland, you can grow there, because of course it's an island. It's the salt level is too high. There's too much sand in the soil. So it's very difficult to grow any other crops like paddy, wheat, or vegetables for that matter. So these are some of the problems which the farmers faced. And that almost concluded like what we did there. I mean, and it is, I always get emotional when I talk about Campbell Bay and Great Nicobar. So with that emotion, I would like to just acknowledge or just say thank you to so many people, because I've been waiting for an opportunity to thank many of them. So my two brothers in crime were there, Arijit and Avdhoot. Arijit is on the right. I used both their worst photos so that they can kill me later. And my guy, Dr. H.N. Kumara from SACON, and directors from SACON, who was very, the former director and the present director, who were very supportive. then DST, Government of India, Andaman Nicobar Forest Department, Andaman Nicobar Agriculture Department, who helped us with the logistics and getting permits and everything. Dr. Mewa Singh and is like a mentor to me, and he has always helped me out with all the time, whatever I needed. And sometimes I have worked without funding, and he was the one who helped me out. Otherwise, it would have been impossible for me to complete my job. And I'm really indebted to few people whose name I have to say. And these are like the five warriors, the women warriors who actually came all the way from mainland to Nicobar. Sneha, Dee, Marisha, Nikita and Sheetal. They had spent quite some time there, I would say. And they have helped me out a lot in gathering my data. I wouldn't have done my work without them. That is for sure. And it goes without saying that the people of Campbell Bay have been absolutely amazing. So there have been times where banks would be closed. So there is no internet there. I mean, the internet you might be using 10, 15 years from now. Like you start making tea, you open Google and you finish the tea and started having tea, and maybe the Google just opens up. But not on the computer, you cannot do it on computer. So again, you can imagine the connectivity is so poor. So ATMs did not work. So we did not have money. But people were so, so gracious. And like the person in the middle, Seema, because of him, we survived there. He was amazing. And this is the family I really want to talk about. And because I really want to give my it's a memoriam kind of a thing, because I have been wanting to do that. So Avdhoot used to go on a boat with Nicobaris to all these three islands to understand the population of these. And Mr. Avivo, who is like a really a very nice person, and he was always smiling. And so he was scared of water when it was too high. And Avdhoot thought they are seafarers, they will not be afraid of it. So he was a really charming man. And unfortunately, on a very stormy night, a tree fell on him, and after a few days he died. It was a really heart-wrenching moment for us. And this is his family. We are very indebted to them. They have helped us a lot for our surveys. This is his wife. He wanted to have a picture, so I thought, why not? And these are the three kids who would follow us everywhere, and the monkeys. And I would also like to thank my dogs, who were my companions when they were nowhere around. No one was around. And of course, my friends and family. And I end this session saying, may the force be with you all, and me being silly. Thank you. And I would like to thank everyone in the audience who could be here today in this really crazy times, and would accompany me to the islands and listen to my talk. Thank you so much. And I would like to thank the organizers for having me here. It's the best way I can spend my evening. I haven't had this good evening for a long, long time. So thank you for that.
Thank you so much, Partha. It was fantastic talk. I mean, we had few sessions. I just remember we almost done 43 different sessions. There are a few people when we spoke about their subjects. Like I remember Hari is already there. So he spoke about Andaman's reptiles and amphibians. They were talking about the passion, because they can't get away, from that. If there's a choice, they would rather live there in that island. So I mean, similar thing we could actually hear from you. I mean, you are so passionate about those monkeys and those islands. So anyway, we just opened the chat box. I mean, if you have any questions, and you can come there. Unfortunately, Zoom messed up. We couldn't do the Facebook live. So what we'll be doing, we'll upload this in YouTube, and we'll be sharing it soon. I mean, we'll do that. We recorded this session. So if you have any questions, please come. I think there's a few questions coming up. Probably you can check the chat box.
All right. I'll try. So hi, Rubina. Nice to know that you have worked with Shantan. I'm sure you understand what it means to be on the islands. Okay, I'm sorry, the voice is speaking. Questions. Thank you, Sneha, for your great work there. I couldn't have done without you. Since I'm not finding questions, I'm addressing each and every comment, if that is all right with you. Thank you, Ramji. Thank you, Don. Thank you for everything. Gaya. I hope I'm pronouncing your name right. I would like to know what are the other primates. So I would read it aloud. I'm from Sri Lanka. In Sri Lanka, top macaques, Macaca seneca, is endemic to Sri Lanka. Other than top macaques, we have grey langurs, purple-faced leaf monkeys, monkeys. I would like to know what are the other primates recorded in your area. So what are the population of grey langurs? Okay. So thank you, Gaya. So I've been really fortunate to see Trachypithecus petulus in Colombo. So population of grey langurs, I wouldn't know, I'm sorry. But there are good people who can really tell you that. But the problem with the grey langurs is again that there is a taxonomy of it. It's still yet to be completely resolved. We have so many species of them right now. And very soon I'm hoping my very good friend Kunal from IISc is going to resolve the taxonomy once and for all. And I'm sorry I won't be able to tell you the population of grey langurs, because I don't think there is any systematic census for that. Or if it's there, I'm sorry, I won't know about it. And other species, primate species. Okay, so again, so like Sri Lanka, we have a lot of species as well. I mean, this is just if you have followed the earlier slides, I've talked about a few macaques. But we have a lot of langurs. Like we have grey langurs, if I just combine them everything at once. We have Nilgiri langurs, which is endemic to southern India. We have golden langur, which is again endemic to a small patch in northeast India. A new paper had come out from one of my lab mates. I would love to advertise this on this platform. Do read it. His name is Joydeep. Do read his paper. It's very interesting about golden langur. And also we find Fieri's leaf monkey in Tripura. And we also have a lesser ape. We have two gibbons, Western Hulog gibbons and Eastern Hulog gibbons. I think I've covered them all. So yeah, we have quite a few. Okay. Just a second, Did the challenges create a problem in statistics? In some ways, I would say. But we had to compromise at some point of time. We couldn't have proper seasonal data like every... So we wanted to have each month data or each seasonal data. But we could not really do it. We could have looked at each season, month, how the things are different, because seasonal changes vary a lot even during a month. Some of the months are so rainy that you can really step out. So it was difficult for some of the statistics, and we hope the challenges were not there, but I think we made the day for every field work out there, or even lab work, I would say. It was wonderful. Thank you, Mutahir. Good that you could make it. How many macaques could be found in a group? Okay, so that can be variable. So usually we say that the group sizes are smaller in township areas, and in the forest areas they will be larger. So what I have seen in Nicobar, the smallest group was I think ours, which at the lowest point of time, where there's the least individuals, were 18 individuals, including the infants. And the largest one which we saw was around 100. So you can see the range of it. And the 100 one was around, I think, near the forest, I think. Hi, Sharad. What about pandanus fruit? Are they wild? No. So there are two species of wild pandanus that we find there. I'm not sure if they are introduced. They don't seem to be introduced. But I wouldn't know because I have not done their phylogeny. So they are actually not cultivated. They grow very easily on the coastal areas. And Nicobaris, as well as the macaques, they are both dependent on pandanus. So Nicobaris, many of the food actually is, they make a lot of dish from pandanus itself, the ripe pandanus. So even that, then it is not, I don't think this is cultivated, it just grew naturally there. Is there any way we can help the monkeys access to Ubi? Yeah, so that's a good question, I would say. And again, it's a thing, the message which we all of the primate logists always give, that do not feed the monkeys. Do not feed the monkeys when you see them in the wild. See, because they do not know, when they see food, they know they have to eat. They do not know it is yours, this is mine. So once you feed these monkeys with your hand, it becomes a habit for them. And they do not know how to get, which is the right way to get it. So the best way is not feed them and maintain your distance as much as they can. So that, in short, can answer that. Since there aren't many large carnivores on the island, the Mugak don't have natural predator, I guess. How is the population controlled? So again, it's a good question. There are no natural predator that we know of. The population control, I would say, will be due to the distribution of food out there. It's patchy and they're dependent on mostly coastal habitat. In the rainforest, again, you don't get too many food species which you can be dependent on. So I would say it would be more of a carrying capacity of that case, that how much it can feed. And I think it's more about the vegetation and the and how much it can feed the number of individuals after that. So as you mentioned, there were few, Riddhi says again that as you mentioned, there are few challenges like falling to reach before sunrise, failing to reach before sunrise. There are. So that times we can't do much about it and we just have to do the best we can. How much interaction do the different groups have? Okay, these are interesting questions because, again, I will advertise one of my papers, our papers, where we see the between group encounters between the groups. So there are five groups in our area where we used to study demography and the population of these groups. They used to, they have a lot of overlapping in each other's home ranges, you know. So the thing is, my group was very small. The other groups were larger. So what they did was, they used to be on the prowl always, looking out for, okay, there are other groups as well. And so they used to avoid the other groups and they did not really, they would make sure, so individuals will go up high on the tree, look around, if they can see other individuals or the groups, and they would avoid. So that's the best methodology they have found to avoid conflict, because they know that they cannot win. And I would recommend you to read the paper if you want. How do they communicate with each other? Because macaques are very interesting. Yes, you're right, Vinayak. They have very interesting and very interesting calls, because and it differs so much, and it is very context based. They communicate each other in a variety of calls, and not only from vocal communication. Each touch means something different. So there is a neutral touch. There is grooming. Along with that communication, they have facial expression as well. So they do, you might have seen, they might do this brow raising thing, or they open their mouth, which shows aggression. And sometimes they will just, with their lips, they just do this, which means they are submissive. So there is kind of a communication with the other individual. And when it comes to vocal, they are again very, very vocal about things, because they give loud alarm calls when they see humans around or they see dogs around. And they with each other, they have other coo calls, like small coo kind of, which for which they just communicate with each other, like they see everyone is around. If they are lost, again there is a different isolation coo call, and there is a different kind of calls. So it can be very context based. Do the local tribes Champin and Nicobaris hunt these macaques? Not that I know of for consumption. Nicobar, Champin, they are no recorded to eat, consume the macaques as a part of their diet, but it might have gone really down. Nicobaris, I wouldn't know much because I haven't seen them hunting. Not the macaques at least. Could you tell about group size, number of groups on the island? So I wouldn't be able to tell you the group of the island because I did not cover the whole island because it was really difficult to traverse throughout the island and see where they all are. So group size, again, as I have mentioned, again, they can vary from 15 to 105, which I have seen. With the group number, I won't be able to tell you. Sorry. Hari. Hey, hi, Hari. So when and how these macaques reach these islands? I don't know. Being straightforward, I really don't know. The literature says that they reached here after Pleistocene, once the glacial after these islands could have just gotten away from Southeast Asia or the Indonesia, could have been one of the things. And the phylogenetic analysis which we did, which is still left, is showing that the population, the DNA of these macaques is very close to the one from Java. So again, how and when, I do not have a definitive answer. I'm sorry. Yeah, thank you so much. Is there anybody currently working on a macaque? Yes, I think there are groups who are working on human macaque interactions there. Shayantan, he's working there. I think there are other work that's also going on about Tulus from ICER Mohali. And these two are only I'm aware of right now. And who spoke about Sahamata? You spoke about adaptation. Would you please give some example how macaques adapted themselves in Nicobar after tsunami? Good question. We were not there immediately after tsunami. We were there in 2013, which was like 9 years after tsunami. So what I can say, connecting the dots, is like in many places where they live in a place which is difficult to stay, it has been seen that they innovate with novel behaviors to process foods. One example which I want to give is a Tulus video which I have seen. So many of these food species, mango, cashew, if you see the forest group, they don't eat this. Only when these groups, they have been pushed towards human habitation, they started eating this cashew and mangoes. And with so adaptation, in a way, they have done that they know how to manipulate in a way that they can make the maximum out of whatever they are getting. So I would say the Tulus is a brilliant example of how they have adapted to the food that is available and how they can access to that. Were there any cases of domesticated and captive ones in the islanders, by the islanders? So captive ones is there because sometimes. So in Port Blair Zoo near Chidiya Tapu, if any of you have been there, there is a big zoo or a big open area where they are keeping many macaques there just for the zoo purpose, I would say. Domesticated, there are a few isolated cases because some of them have been rescued. So one individual in our group, he did not have a arm because he was tied very strongly to something, and then he tried, and then they just forgot him, and he just stayed there, and this one got tied, and he had to lose an arm. So there are isolated cases of domestication, but in Little Nicobar there are some cases where Little Nicobar, the Nicobarese people have I wouldn't say domesticated, because you don't really cannot domesticate. When you domesticate some animal, you use them for particular reason. So I would say they must have kept them like a pet or something. Because unlike pigtail macaques, which are found in Thailand, for pigtail macaques in Thailand, they are trained to get coconuts for the farmers. None of those things are known from this fascicularis from islands. David, what is your lifespan? So lifespan, okay. So this is something I would like you to find. This is very easy because I would like some information to come, because I would say something from 20 to 30. Now you can look it up. This would be a task. What is the best solution?
Because you said 15 or something, no? It's something in between.
Right. So that's yes. They live longer than that. They live longer than that.
Okay.
It's a fun question to think of. Because why am I saying it's a fun question? Because again, I would like all of you to go and read up a bit about why would animal, when they cannot give birth to an individual anymore, would like to have their lifespan extended. In the end, we all know that the evolution, it works only when we increase the number of genes. So what is the point of having a long life? You go and read it up. I would like to have you think about it. So what is the best solution to minimize human-monkey conflict? So I have spoke about it a bit before. So it's like the places where you cannot avoid. So stop feeding the monkeys, stop interacting with them at all. And I know sometimes it is difficult when where the at the places where it has gone really hard. And the solutions are there. I mean, in many places they are trying to sterilize the individuals and relocation of the monkeys. But then again, it puts a lot of stress on the individuals as well. And I wouldn't. And the problem again with the monkeys is their smartness. Again, I would say, because there is never a best solution with them, because they are so smart. They will be try. They will mitigate whatever method you use against them. So in Nicobar, they used sheets for coconuts, also areca, where they put 2 feet, 2 meter wide sheets, and they made, you know, wrapped it around the coconut trees so that the monkeys cannot climb. Monkeys didn't need to do this. They could go to the nearest tree and then jump from it. So it was just an example. Why are they crab eating macaques, and when they are almost dependent on coconut and pandanus? Okay, so it's a good question. So the thing is, there is a population of these macaques in, I think, Indonesia and Thailand, which actively hunts crab eating macaques. So we have never seen this population or any of the Nicobar population actively hunting the crabs. If they are just run over by some car or something, they are because of curiosity, they will just come and taste it. But scientific literature also, we are avoiding crab-eating macaque. To use the word crab-eating macaque, we are using the long-tailed macaque, because not every macaque would eat the crab. Thank you, Vinay. Titikya, how does macaque shows? There are very isolated cases. I was talking to someone a few days back, and there was fetal cannibalism in lion-tailed macaque. We haven't seen any of those kind of sort in long-tailed macaque, but in some macaques, it has very isolated reports are there. Where do you see the monkeys in, say, 5 years from now? Also, would India agree with not feeding them? Is keeping a monkey legal? Okay, there are 3 questions from Don. Okay, I'll try to answer them. Where do you see the monkeys in, say, 5 years from now? So the long-tailed macaque, I would say, it depends again on how much of their habitat remains intact, how much the conflict, I would say, the interaction gets to a negative phase where people have to really think about getting a population control or something, which have been a thing, but it is not wise to do that. And other macaques, I would say some macaques are not doing as good. Maybe rhesus macaque, the numbers are very high, but do they live a quality life? I wouldn't really know. Scrolled a lot. Just give me a minute. Sorry. Okay. 5 years from now. So also India would agree that I cannot answer, because we have, I mean, many of us, not just us, forest department, the people, the nature lovers. I mean, I see in my areas bird watchers coming and asking the local tourists not to feed the monkey, which is amazing, I would say, because it all depends on how much we can reach to the people and make them do what we really want without really antagonizing them, I would say. In a way, we have to make people see the bigger picture and see them that, okay, you might see that as a love for these animals, but in the end, it is not. It is kind of harming them as well. And in the long term, it's going to harm you as well. Is keeping a monkey legal? No, I don't think so. I wouldn't suggest that, and it is not legal. any species of, okay, sorry. Thank you everyone for your comments who are saying thank you. Mutahir, have you seen in your experience any examples of excellent memory like it has? Okay, so we haven't really checked memory because memory needs to have a different methodology to check. Okay, they have spatial memory because they know which are the areas to avoid where they have the presence of other groups. But the memory can again be divided into different sections like episodic memory, whether they remember something which has happened to them or do they remember where there are certain kinds of. So I wouldn't like to, you know, make this term umbrella memory for all of them. They definitely have some kind of memory or cognition. I would say that they know where to go, which are the areas they remember could be avoided from the last day's encounter or certain things like that. Okay, that was the last question, I think.
Yes. Yeah. Paritha, can you just mention your email ID so anybody want to...
I would actually... So my email ID... I was supposed to put it down in the slide. I absolutely forgot it. So I'm also very active on Twitter if you want to catch up with me. So the handle is @Paritha_Marcus. And Facebook, I'm... sporadically visiting these days because of the grim news everywhere. Paritha Marcus Mishra. Don't ask me why it's Marcus. Paritha Marcus Mishra. And also the email ID is quite long. So I don't know if I should dictate or just write on a notepad and just... Can all of you access the chat box? Then I can write it there. Right. Okay. I hope you can see it now. I have put it in the chat box. Hello, can anyone hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. It's actually misra.parthasarathi1@gmail.com.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much, Paritha. So it was so wonderful to hear you. It was a fantastic session. I mean, it's...
Thank you so much, David.
Yeah, it's amazing. I mean, I would love to go out and see these monkeys there.
Please go. I would absolutely suggest everyone to just go and understand not only the ecology of that place, but how people live there. And it's very different from what we are accustomed of. Without internet, without ice cream, in this summer, you cannot even think about it without ice cream. But that's how it is.
Oh, okay. So, thank you.
thank you so much, David, for having me here.
And on behalf
of, I would like to thank.
And on behalf of Nature Society and Alapi Naturalistic Society, we extend our thanks, and from all behalf of all the participants. And tomorrow also, please sign up for. There's an amazing talk coming up with one of the. The leading herpetologist from
Yes.
I mean, he recently, I think, a few days ago, he got one species named after him also. So there is. Anyway, so let's hear from him tomorrow.
Absolutely.
Good night, all of you.
Thank you for having me.
Good night.